Exodus chapter 12, verse 38.
Come on.
And a mixed multitude went up also with them, and flocks and herds, even very much cattle.
So when the Most High delivered Israel out of Egypt, he killed the Egyptian army. And running at our heels was a mixed multitude of other nations that was in Egypt as well. Now we get to the wilderness. The other nations is hiding behind us. They there with us. Now watch this. Go to Deuteronomy 28, 43. This is what the Lord told Moses to tell us about these other nations if we break the law.
Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 43. The stranger that is within thee shall...
Stop. The stranger that is within thee, meaning that mixed multitude that y'all got back there. The Lord said, I see them, but I'm going to tell you something about them. Read it again.
The stranger that is within thee shall get up above thee very high, and thou shalt come down very low.
Right now, Israel, in the wilderness, you are the top nation. I'm with you. Fire by day, cloud by night. Fire by night, cloud by day. And that mixed multitude that ran out behind y'all, I'm going to tell you something about them. If you break God's laws, the Lord's going to raise that mixed multitude, them strangers that's within you, above you. That's what he's warning us about. We look back at them little nations. Them dudes back there. Ha! Read.
He shall lend to thee.
Them strangers shall lend to thee.
And thou shalt not lend to him.
Uh-huh.
He shall be the head, and thou shalt be the tail.
Y'all see that? We didn't believe it. We saw them little ragamuffins back behind us. Said, them guys, them little mixed nations. And surely that will never happen. We didn't believe Moses. What he said.
Hey, could he read that again, Bishop, real quick? Read it again. I'm going to show y'all. I'm going to show you the dents of the Negro's brain that try to pervert scripture.
Deuteronomy 28, verse 43. The stranger that is within thee shall get up above thee very high.
So if there's a knucklehead, a numbskull that's out here trying to push the doctrine to say that Moses was talking about everybody that was there as a group of people, let me just show you how stupid people are. Read it again.
The stranger that is within thee.
The Most High is making the distinction between Israel and the nations right there, letting you know they're not the same. Go ahead.
Shall get up above thee very high.
Those people shall get up above my people. Distinction. Go ahead.
And thou shalt come down.
And you, my people,
shall come down very low.
Shall come down below the other people.
He shall lend to thee.
He, the other people, shall lend to you as my people.
And thou shalt not lend to him.
And you, my people, shall not lend to the other people. So what in this world would... just shows you how evil can just cloud your brain from common sense and regular, straight, easy English.
We have a culture, we have a language, we have a history that is very, very important. And these things have been stolen from us. And it is our responsibility, okay, to take back those righteous things that were stolen from us. That's our job. And this should be our pleasure, because it tells us that in the book of Proverbs, let's go to that right quick, the book of Proverbs, the 25th chapter, and I'm going to read the second verse. It says, it is the glory of the Shekinah, okay, it is the glory of the Father to conceal a thing, okay? But the honor of kings is to search out the thing. Now, what I found important with that word thing or matter is the Hebrew word devar. Devar. So I can easily read this now because I'm not changing anything in the scripture. It is the Shekinah, which is, and the Shekinah is the Messiah, of the Father to conceal a saying or utterance. But the honor of kings is to search out the saying of the utterance. All right. So again, I say all of that to say this. It is our job and it's our responsibility to make sure that we search this thing here. The utterance, the saying. Because again, every verse, okay, is a seed. And we have to make sure that we understand exactly what's going on in these scriptures here. We're talking about the basic level of understanding our people can't understand now. I'm talking about collectively. And I'm not saying this now to mock or make fun of anybody, but what I'm saying now is that it's time for us to really step our game up and understand exactly what's going on here. To explain to you the importance of Hebrew, because the message has not changed. It's very important for us to understand Hebrew. If you can understand all these love songs and all these hip-hop songs, it should be no problem for us, the nation of Israel, to come back into our identity and try to understand some Hebrew. It's very, very important, all right? A lot of us seem to believe that the way that the Bible is written now in English, or American, whatever you want to call it, this was not the language that they spoke over 3,000-4,000 years ago. They didn't speak that. They spoke the Aramaic, Hebrew, Sumerian language. This what we speak, this English that we speak here now is less than 700 years old. Less than 700 years old. We have to come back to our culture so we can get a clearer understanding of what's going on here. Ecclesiastes 13. At midday, O king, this is Shaul speaking. All right, his Hebrew name is Shaul, not Paul. At midday, O king, I saw in the way a light from heaven, above the brightness of the sun, shining round about me, and them which journeyed with me. And when we were all fallen to the earth, I heard a voice speaking unto me, saying in the Hebrew tongue, Lashawan Kodash, the Hebrew tongue. All right? The word is Hebrew. That's your language. His name is Shaul. Saying in the Hebrew tongue, Shaul, Shaul, why persecutest thou me? So when it says, why persecutest thou me? All of that was Hebrew. All of it. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. What are the pricks? You can't stop, okay, what's going on here. What's going on here today is the Spirit of Yah. So everything that's been said here in verse 14, okay, is in Lashawan Kodash, Hebrew. Get to understand and know your language. And again, I just wanted to bring out the importance of the Hebrew language. The message hasn't changed, and it should be no problem with us coming back into our true identity. It's been a long time coming, a very long time coming. We have to understand that we have to come back into covenant relationship with the Messiah. You have your own language. You have your own names. Okay, you have your own land. Yerushalayim is the name of the land. That's where you were. That's where you were exiled from. So they were not calling the Messiah Jesus. All right. They were not calling the Messiah Jesus. His name is Yeshua, or it's called in tones, Yahawashai. Make sure that you get the thing correct. We can't be polluted by Christianity. We are Hebrew Israelites. As such, this is the Hebrew alphabet. A, Ba, Ga, Da, Ha, Wa, Za, Ka, Ta, Ya, Ka, La, Ma, Na, Sa, I, Pa, Taza, Kwa, Ra, Sha, Tha. The word Genesis is the word Bereshit, which means the beginning. The word Exodus is the word Shemot. The word Leviticus is Varikra. The word Numbers is Bamdabar, which means in the desert. The word Deuteronomy is Devarim, which means words. It's very important that we understand this, all right? Because this is part of your culture. This is part of your identity. You are not African Americans, all right? You have a name. You have a nationality. You're not black. Black is a color. Black is not describing a nationality. Who are you? The scriptures tell us that when we go into the land of exile, is that you're going to forget your identity. And it's quite obvious when we talk to people that we don't know who we are today. Now, let's bring some more edification here, because everything can be brought out in the scriptures. Let's go to the prologue in Ecclesiasticus in the Apocrypha. So we're going to read the second part of this, and we're going to get further edification on the importance of Hebrew. Lashawan Kodash. Wherefore, let me entreat you to read it with favor and attention, and to pardon us wherein we may seem to come short of some words. Because what these guys are trying to do now, they're trying to translate the Greek, okay, into Hebrew. And when you start to change the Greek into Hebrew, there's a lot of the words don't mesh together. There's no equivalent to Hebrew words in Greek. Watch this. And to pardon us where we may seem to come short of some words which we have labored to interpret. That's very important. For the same things uttered in Hebrew and translated into a other tongue have not the same force in them. And not only these things, but the law, the Torah itself, and the prophets and the rest of the books have no small difference. That is very important. Extremely important, people. We must make sure that we understand the Hebrew. I'm not saying that it's a requirement that you have to understand the Hebrew to make it into the kingdom, but it would be very beneficial when you begin to speak that you speak with intelligence. That way nobody can trip you up. So the better your language or frequency that you have with the Hebrew language, the better off you will be.
And a mixed multitude went up also with them. Some of these were Egyptians, and some of other nations that had resided in Egypt, and who, on various accounts, might choose to go along with the children of Israel, some through intermarriages with them, being loath to part with their relations. See Leviticus 20:10. A great mixed multitude, cf. Numbers 11, 4, the head word different, non-Israelites, cf. The same word in Nehemiah 13, 3, of various kinds are meant, for example Egyptians who had intermarried with Israelites, cf. Leviticus 24:10. One thing we do know from the text, a mixed multitude accompanied the 12 tribes of Jacob as they set out toward Palestine, neither fully Jewish nor fully Egyptian. These racially mixed people were the sons and daughters of one Hebrew parent and one Egyptian. The product of two separate and competing cultures, these half-breeds were perhaps too Egyptian to really fit in with the children of Israel, and definitely too Jewish to be completely comfortable among their Egyptian brethren. In Exodus 12:38, we read that when the Israelites left Egypt, a mixed multitude went up with them. Therefore, the question arises, who were the mixed multitude? Interestingly, the word is also attested to at the time of Nehemiah. In Nehemiah 13, 3, the term Eriv is linked to Nehemiah's reforms against intermarriages. According to Deuteronomy 29 hours and 10 minutes, they seem to have occupied a very low position among the Israelites, and to have furnished the nation of God with hewers of wood and drawers of water. In a social context, the Tzar is similar to the Neker Nakri, typically a non-Israelite outsider, but the term can also designate an Israelite who is perceived as an outsider by members of his/her family or tribe. 37. After the death of all the firstborn in Egypt, the Pharaoh and the Egyptians urged the Israelites to make a hasty departure, but before they leave the land of their bondage, the Israelites plundered the Egyptians. 100 They journeyed from Rameses to Succoth, about 600,000 men on foot, besides children. A mixed crowd also went with them, and livestock in great numbers, both flocks and herds. Exodus 12:37-39 101. Myers, Exodus, 100. The numbers are exaggerated to assert the growth of the population in Egypt. The mixed crowd may refer to those who intermarried with Israelites. See, 9:11:4, Lev 24:10.
I'm working on my Hebrew, and my mind's not twisting back to English so well.
So the next word for stranger is zor. This word is stranger, some translation. And this, some translation has alien, but stranger, okay? This is another type of stranger. Ger is a stranger. But ger is what they call a proselyte, for the most part. But now we're working on the word zor. Let's go see what this word means. So let's look at Yeshayahu or Isaiah chapter 61, verse 4. Isaiah or Yeshayahu chapter 61, verse 4. Now I'll probably get some slack when I probably upload this to YouTube, but I want you to understand, my whole purpose of this is not to say I'm some person that just loves nations. This is not my objective.
You're a nation lover.
Right, nation lover. I said, that's not what I'm after here. I'm actually after what the Word says and just kind of walk with what the Father says. So I'm not really worried about what man thinks of the lesson. I'm more so concerned about how the Father thinks of how we're producing this lesson. Okay, so this is why I'd rather read it first and then just take from it what it says literally.
Right.
You know, versus spiritualizing it because it's not fitting our doctrine. You know what I mean when I say spiritualizing it? Like, it says you are not to mix with the nation. Do you just read what it said? It just says you're not to mix with the white people. You see what happened? I took what this said and changed it to what I wanted to say.
Right.
Keep in mind, a lot of the nations that it says not mixed with were all dark-skinned nations. Mm-hmm. But we want to elevated to say, back then, yes, that's what that meant back then, but today, they're talking about them.
Right.
You see? We can't do that. So we're just going to read from what it says literally. All right, so, Yeshayahu, or Isaiah 61, verse 4, starts off with this. It says, and they shall build the old waste, they shall raise up former desolations, and they shall repair the waste cities, the desolations of many generations. Verse 5 says, and the zor, or the strangers, shall stand and feed your flock. Okay? These are zors that are going to feed your flock. And then it says, and the sons of the alien, the nakar, we're going to talk about nakar in just a minute. That's another type. The nakar shall be your plowmen and your vine dressers.